Welcome back, everyone, for another deep dive. This time, we're really diving deep into the mind of a writer named John McElhenney.
Oh, yeah, I saw this one.
Yeah, he's got this one blog post. It's fascinating, this post, because it's part personal journey, part literary analysis, and honestly, maybe even a little bit of spiritual awakening, all in one blog post. So we figured we'd ask, what can we learn about this guy from this single post, this single piece of writing?
Well, he definitely seems to use this blog post as a way to showcase his influences, kind of put them all out there.
Yeah, he's not shy about it.
No, not at all.
He's really not. It seems like right away we get the sense that McElhenney's a deep thinker, probably in his 50s or 60s.
Yeah, sounds about right.
He mentions graduating from UT Austin with an English degree back in 87 and a 12-year marriage that ended sometime before that.
Wow.
But it's his passion for literature that really jumps out at you.
Oh, yeah, for sure.
You get this massive list of authors and books.
Right.
And it's a really eclectic mix.
It is.
He mentions Vonnegut, Murakami, even some lesser-known names. Like, have you ever heard of Kathy Acker?
I have heard of Kathy Acker.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
I mean, she's pretty niche.
But that's what makes the list so interesting. You get the sense that he's not just reading the classics or the popular stuff. He's really seeking out different voices.
Was a seeker.
Yeah,
absolutely. And even some of the specific titles he throws out, like Slapstick by Vonnegut.
Oh, yeah. Great one.
It's hilarious and heartbreaking all at the same time. And he even mentions The Waves by Virginia Woolf.
That's a tough one.
Which is, well, let's just say it's a journey into the depths of human consciousness. But he seems to be up for it. And then, of course, he calls himself a, quote, reconstructed individual.
What do you make of that?
I don't know. What do you think?
I think it speaks to the idea that he's gone through these really transformative experiences and come out the other side, like, reshaped by them. Makes you kind of think about your own life.
Yeah.
How have your own experiences reconstructed you?
Yeah, that's a deep question.
It is.
And then there's Walt Whitman.
Of course, we can't forget Walt Whitman.
Right. The elephant, or maybe I should say the bard, in the room. He goes all in on Whitman, even refers to himself as, quote, WaltWhitman.AI. Is that, like, brilliant or a little pretentious, do you think?
It's a choice.
It's a choice.
It is a choice. I mean, maybe he's trying to position himself as, you know, the modern day Whitman.
Yeah.
Carrying on that torch of self-expression.
Truthfully.
Whitman was all about breaking down those barriers. Celebrating the individual.
Mm-hmm.
Embracing the complexities of life. And maybe McElhenney's trying to do the same thing in his own way.
Be that raw and honest.
Yeah.
Yeah. But, okay. But then he gets fixated on colons.
Colons.
Yes. He goes on and on about Whitman's use of colons and how groundbreaking it was, how it inspired his own writing style, something that he calls, quote, language poetry, which honestly, I don't even know what that is.
Well, language poetry is pretty out there. It can be really dense and experimental. Really focuses on the sound and the structure of language.
Yeah.
Not exactly a beach read.
Okay.
But what I find interesting is how he sees the colon as like this almost mystical symbol.
Oh, connection.
Yeah, connection flow. Do you see that?
Honestly, I don't know. It feels a little overblown to me.
Okay.
Like, I don't know if I buy that a colon can be that profound. But he does make an interesting point about how Whitman used colons to break down traditional sentence structures.
Right.
Create a certain rhythm in his work. And he tries to do the same thing in his own writing.
Interesting.
He even gives an example, like comparing a line from Song of Myself with his own, you know, colon-filled version.
So maybe the takeaway here isn't so much about the colon itself,
but more about the way we use language.
Yeah, paying attention to that music of language, the rhythm, the emphasis, the flow.
That's a good point. It's not about imitating Whitman exactly. It's more about learning from him.
Yeah, finding your own voice, your own way to make the words sing.
Exactly.
That's something we can all try to do.
Whether we're using colons or not.
Exactly.
So we've got this guy, McElhenney, loves literature. But this blog post goes way beyond books. He gets really personal. Like, really personal. Talking about his struggles with his father, his divorce.
Oh, yeah, he gets into it.
He even talks about this, like, intense experience he had where he felt the presence of the, quote, Holy Ghost.
Wow.
While, you know, in an altered state with a friend. And it seems like this event really shook him.
Absolutely. It's like a pivotal moment for him, a turning point.
Yeah, he describes it as, like, challenging his beliefs. Like, it forced him to confront some big questions.
About life, about spirituality. And it's interesting how he ties this back to literature, specifically to Whitman. Like, they're both paths to understanding the mysteries of existence.
Do you think reading Whitman, like, primed him for that experience?
That's a good question. Hard to say.
Yeah.
But I think it shows how powerful literature can be.
Yeah.
It can open your mind to new possibilities, new ways of seeing the world. And for McElhenney, maybe Whitman's work gave him the language.
Yeah.
To make sense of that experience.
So it's not necessarily about answers, but it's about having the tools.
Right, the tools to grapple with those big questions.
Yeah. And he's not afraid to ask them. He talks about loss, regret. He even mentions terrible things he's done in the past. But there's also this thread of hope. This resilience. He talks about the importance of time at craft.
Yeah, that really resonated with me. It's like his version of finding solace and purpose.
In creative work.
Exactly.
Like almost like a refuge. What do you think he means by like letting go of outcomes?
I think it's about focusing on the process, not getting too hung up on the results.
Just enjoying the creative work for its own sake.
Exactly. Being present in the moment.
Mm-hmm.
Letting go of expectations. He even talks about applying this to his relationships.
Yeah.
With his children. Just cherishing the time they have. Not trying to mold them into something specific.
Huh. Almost like a Zen approach to life. Just accepting what is. Finding joy in the simple things.
Right.
And speaking of simple things, he talks about this really profound experience he had just watching his cat.
His cat?
Yeah, his cat, Peter, staring into the flames of a fireplace with a friend.
Okay.
I know it sounds random, but he describes it as like a spiritual connection.
I love that. It shows you can find meaning and connection in the most unexpected places.
It really does. It makes you wonder what his everyday life is like. He mentions making coffee for his partner, working on his writing, spending time with his kids. He even invites readers to visit him, offers coffee and a warm fire.
There's a real generosity there.
Yeah.
An openness, a willingness to share those simple pleasures.
So we've got this multifaceted guy, brilliant, a little eccentric, connected to literature, seeking spiritual truth. But I keep coming back to why this intense focus on Walt Whitman.
Well, remember, Whitman was a revolutionary. He broke the mold, embraced the language of everyday people, celebrated the body and soul, all of it.
And McElhenney seems to be channeling that in his writing. He's not afraid to experiment, to be vulnerable, lay it all out there.
Right. He's pushing boundaries, just like Whitman did. He's fascinated by that vastness of human experience.
Yeah, ups and downs, the good, the bad, and everything in between.
Exactly. Like he's found a kindred spirit in Whitman.
Yeah, and he's using Whitman's work as a guide, a map for his own creative and spiritual journey. But, okay, how does this apply to us?
Most of us aren't going to become Whitman scholars.
Right.
So what's the takeaway here? I think it's about finding those voices, those sources of inspiration that speak to you.
Yeah, whether it's a writer, a musician, artist, whoever. Someone who challenges you to think differently, to see the world with fresh eyes.
Exactly.
Like McElhenney saying, hey, if Whitman can help me, maybe he can help you too.
And it goes beyond writing. It's about finding your own way of being in the world, your own rhythm, your own song.
Your own voice.
Yes, and embracing your individuality, your passions. And letting them shine through.
And you know it's not always going to be perfect or pretty. McElhenney's pretty open about that, the fact that he's messed up. He's made mistakes.
Yeah, he even says he's done some terrible things.
But it seems like he's found a way to move on, to accept those imperfections and find a sense of purpose.
I think that's really important.
Yeah.
To acknowledge those flaws, learn from the past, focus on the present.
He even calls the day he wrote this post, December 26, 2023, his, quote, birthday.
It's like he's starting fresh, shedding that old skin.
Oh, that's an interesting way to put it. Like he's being reborn, but then he goes and compares himself to John Galt.
John Galt from The Fountainhead.
Yeah, that fiercely individualistic hero.
That's a bold statement.
It is. It makes you think. Maybe he sees himself as a maverick, someone who doesn't care about fitting in.
What if we all embraced our inner John Galt?
Ooh, that's a good question. What would that even look like?
Expressing ourselves without holding back. Tapping into that creative energy.
Yeah, like what are we holding ourselves back from? What are we so afraid of?
Exactly. And McElhenney seems to be saying, just go for it.
Yeah.
Put yourself out there, even if it's messy, even if it's not perfect.
He even talks about pushing his writing into the cloud for release. Like he's letting it go.
Surrendering to the unknown. Trusting that it'll find its way.
There's a real beauty in that. So after all this time with John McElhenney and his words, what do we take away from all of this? What's the big takeaway from this deep dive?
I think it's about embracing the messiness, embracing the complexity of life, finding that beauty in unexpected places.
Yeah. It's okay to be different, to challenge the norms, express yourself authentically.
And find those sources of inspiration, the things that speak to you on a deeper level, like he found in Whitman.
Right. Like whether it's a writer or a musician or, I don't know, a cat staring into a fire.
Exactly.
It's about finding your tribe, your kindred spirits.
Yeah, the people and things that light you up.
Yeah. And never forgetting those human connections, those moments we share.
That make life worth living.
I think that's a great place to end it. Hopefully this deep dive has given you some new perspectives, maybe even a little inspiration.
Definitely check out some of the books and authors we talked about.
Yeah, you might just find your next favorite.
Or rediscover an old one in a whole new light.
Well, thanks for joining us on this journey. And until next time, keep exploring, keep questioning, and keep diving deep.
See you next time.